Selamat malam, Bapak-Ibu sekalian yang mengikuti webinar pada malam hari ini. Juga selamat pagi dan selamat siang bagi Anda yang tinggal di belahan dunia yang berbeda. Perkenalkan, nama saya Budi Setiamarga dari Institut Lemena. Selamat datang dalam webinar internasional yang berjudul Literasi Keagamaan Lintas Budaya, Pendekatan Baru untuk Kerjasama Multiagama, seraya memperkuat iman Anda sendiri. Webinar ini diselenggarakan dalam kerjasama antara Universitas Nahdlatul Ulama Indonesia dan Institut Lemena. Kami dari Universitas Nahdlatul Ulama Indonesia dan Institut Lemena ingin mengucapkan salam hormat kepada Bapak-Ibu sekalian, seluruh peserta yang ada di Indonesia atau dimanapun Anda berada. Sebagai informasi, sampai dengan pukul 20 lebih 10 menit yang lalu, ada 1.831 peserta yang mendaftar yang berasal dari 287 kota dan 23 negara. Ini tentu menggembirakan dan menunjukkan bahwa topik webinar ini memang sangat menarik. Bapak-Ibu sekalian, mencari solusi bagi tantangan global membutuhkan berbagai perspektif yang berbeda serta kerjasama antar individu dan institusi yang belum tentu memiliki nilai-nilai yang sama. Pada tingkat nasional, kemerdekaan Indonesia pada tahun 1945 berhasil dicapai berkat kompetensi para pendiri bangsa dari berbagai latar belakang agama dan kepercayaan untuk dapat bekerjasama mencapai tujuan bersama, tanpa harus mengorbankan iman kepercayaannya masing-masing atau berusaha mendominasi yang lain. Kompetensi yang mendasar bagi kehidupan bersama dan kerjasama yang damai dalam masyarakat plural ini semakin tergerus oleh berkembangnya paham intoleran dan ekstremisme. Hal ini terjadi tidak hanya di Indonesia, tapi juga di berbagai bagian dunia lainnya. Oleh karena itu, sementara penduduk dunia semakin beragam agamanya, kompetensi demikian yang seringkali diabaikan menjadi semakin penting bagi kemajuan peradaban kemanusiaan. Literasi keagamaan lintas budaya adalah sebuah pendekatan baru yang kreatif dalam memetakan kompetensi mendasar ini, sehingga kita dapat mengembangkannya dalam diri kita untuk terlibat dalam kerjasama multiagama tanpa kehilangan identitas agama kita sendiri. Kita akan membahas konsep literasi keagamaan ini serta menelusurinya dari perspektif Islam dan pengalaman kehidupan beragama dan antar agama di Indonesia dan Pakistan. Kita semua patut bergembira dan berterima kasih karena adanya narasumber yang mumpuni dalam webinar internasional kita kali ini. Dr. Chris Seipel akan menjelaskan konsep literasi keagamaan lintas budaya, latar belakang dan visinya, serta kompetensi dan keterampilan yang perlu dikembangkan. Dr. Minhas Majid Khan akan membahasnya dari perspektif pengalaman di Pakistan, mengapa dan bagaimana literasi keagamaan lintas budaya dapat diterapkan dan apa tantangannya. Dr. Awi Shihab akan membahas konsep literasi keagamaan lintas budaya ini dari perspektif Islam dan kesesuaiannya dengan konteks kehidupan beragama dan antar agama di Indonesia. Mari kita mulai saja webinar kita ini. Untuk itu, pertama-tama kami mempersilahkan yang terhormat Bapak Dr. H. Syahrizal Syarif, MPH, PhD, Wakil Rektor 1 Bidang Akademik Universitas Nahdlatul Ulama Indonesia untuk memberikan kata sambutannya. Kepada Bapak Dr. Syahrizal Syarif, kami persilahkan.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Peace and greeting for all of us. Ladies and gentlemen, very good evening for those who are in Jakarta and Peshawar, And very good morning for those who are in United States or the other countries. Praise gratitude to God Almighty, the creator of universe. Thanks to his grace, so in the middle of period of pandemic COVID-19 here, we can gather and follow this webinar. First of all, let me, as a vice rector of for academic affairs of University of Nahdlatul Ulama, on behalf of UNUSIA rector, express a gratitude that amounted to the Lemena Institute on this collaboration, so this important webinar can be held. Thanks, Mr. Matthews Ho, my brother, the executive director, the Lemena Institute, who is already present among us. And in my honor, it is my honor to greet a gratitude and appreciation to our excellent resource person that's already introduced. First of all, we honor Dr. Alwi Shihab, a senior fellow of Lemena Institute and former president special and for the Middle East and the OIC. Secondly, we honor Dr. Chris Seppel, the senior fellow of the University of Washington. And thirdly, our honorable Dr. Minhas Majid Khan, professor from University of Peshawar, Pakistan. I believe that the webinar will provide a fruitful and useful understanding about the cross-cultural literacy concepts and perspective in multi-faith collaboration. Finally, thanks for organizing committee, both from UNUSIA and the Lemena Institute, that make this webinar possible. And lastly, thanks for all the honored participants that there's already mentioned 1,300 something. Thank you very much from many area and many countries. Thanks. Again, wallahu muwaffiq ila aqwamit thariq. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Terima kasih Bapak Dr. Syahrizal Syarif. Selanjutnya kami mengundang Bapak Matthews Ho, Direktur Eksekutif Institut Lemena untuk memberikan sambutannya. Silakan Pak Matthews.
Terima kasih, Pak Budi. Selamat malam, salam sejahtera untuk kita semua. Yang terhormat Bapak Dr. Haji Syahrizal Syarif, PhD, Wakil Rektor 1 Bidang Akademik Universitas Nahdlatul Ulama Indonesia yang mewakili Bapak Rektor Profesor Dr. Maksum Mahfudz. Para narasumber, Profesor Dr. Alwi Shihab, Dr. Chris Seipel di Amerika Serikat, dan Dr. Minhas Majid Khan di Pakistan. Hadirin peserta webinar yang berbahagia, puji syukur kepada Tuhan Yang Maha Esa atas rahmat dan karunia-Nya kepada kita semua, sehingga hari ini kita dapat membahas topik yang amat penting dan relevan bagi masyarakat yang majemuk, tidak hanya di Indonesia, tetapi juga di banyak belahan dunia lainnya. Topik ini semakin penting karena kemampuan membangun relasi dan kerjasama dalam keberagaman semakin tergerus oleh sikap intoleran dan ketakutan terhadap yang berbeda. Komunitas terpecah-pecah semakin kecil. Intoleransi tidak mengenal batas. Kami dari Institut Lemena berterima kasih kepada Universitas Nahdlatul Ulama Indonesia atau UNUSIA atas kerjasamanya untuk acara yang penting ini. Kami sangat menghargai kerjasama ini dan semoga ini menjadi langkah awal dari rangkaian webinar yang dapat ikut membangun kebersamaan dalam keberagaman, baik di Indonesia maupun di berbagai belahan dunia lainnya. Saya tertarik dengan motto UNUSIA, Knowledge, Faith, and Wisdom. Pengetahuan, keimanan, dan kearifan atau hikmat. Motto dari Universitas Nahdlatul Ulama Indonesia. Pertama, karena motto ini mengingatkan saya pada ayat di Alkitab, yaitu Amsal 1 ayat 7, yang mengatakan, takut akan Tuhan adalah permulaan pengetahuan, tetapi orang bodoh menghina hikmat dan didikan. Kedua, literasi keagamaan lintas budaya yang akan kita bahas hari ini tidak mempertentangkan, tetapi justru mengkaitkan pengetahuan, keimanan, dan kearifan ini. Pengetahuan dicapai tanpa meninggalkan keimanan. Keimanan diperkuat tanpa menutup diri terhadap pengetahuan. Lantas, pengetahuan dan keimanan yang diterapkan dalam masyarakat majemuk inilah yang akan turut membuahkan kearifan. Hari ini kita beruntung dapat mendalami lebih jauh topik ini bersama para tokoh terkemuka. Dr. Chris Seipel adalah tokoh yang mengembangkan teori literasi keagamaan ini. Dr. Minhas Majid Khan di Pakistan ikut menulis mengenai literasi keagamaan ini dari pengalaman Pakistan dalam buku yang diedit Dr. Seipel dan akan rencananya terbit tahun ini. Sedangkan Profesor Dr. Arwi Shihab yang tidak asing lagi bagi kita semua adalah tokoh cendekiawan Islam yang telah banyak berperan dalam kemajuan dialog dan kerjasama lintas agama. Terima kasih atas kehadiran para narasumber dan peserta webinar dimanapun Anda berada. Semoga acara ini dapat mendorong lebih banyak percakapan dan kerjasama antar umat beragama yang berbeda demi kebaikan bersama dan kemajuan peradaban manusia. Selamat beracara.
Terima kasih Bapak Matius Ho. Setelah ini, tiga orang narasumber kita akan menyampaikan pemaparannya. Setelah selesai pemaparan dari ketiga narasumber, maka akan ada sesi tanya-jawab. Silakan kapan saja selama pemaparan, Anda dapat mengirimkan pertanyaan melalui kotak Q&A. Sekarang, saya ingin mempersilakan Dr. Chris Seipel, Senior Fellow di University of Washington, Amerika Serikat, serta Principal Advisor di Templeton Region Trust untuk memberikan pemaparannya. Kepada Dr. Chris Seipel, kami persilahkan, waktunya 15 menit.
Good evening, and assalamu alaikum to my Muslim friends and brothers and sisters around the world, and special greetings to those in Indonesia, and a great thanks to Nahdlatul Ulama University, as well as the Lamina Institute for hosting this conversation. For many years, I worked for an organization called the Institute for Global Engagement, working on issues of religion and realpolitik and reconciliation. And I spent time in working throughout East Asia and especially Southeast Asia. And in my prayers, I began to feel that I was supposed to leave. I was supposed to begin to give back some of the lessons of engagement that I had learned over 15 and 20 years to help equip people, because I was not equipped to do the things that I was doing in Asia and Southeast Asia. I was learning as I went. And so as I left the Institute for Global Engagement, two opportunities came to me. One was the opportunity to advise the Templeton Religion Trust, a global philanthropy out of the Bahamas, about a new funding initiative. And second was an opportunity to teach at the University of Washington, which I began to do in 2018. The Templeton Religion Trust, as a first activity for them, they sent me to Indonesia in January of 2017. And this is where I began to see my prayers answered, because I began to understand and begin to develop a framework for the lessons that I had learned. Because in Indonesia, I experienced an Indonesian Islam that I had not experienced in other parts of the world. It was an Islam that was theologically orthodox, yet very comfortable engaging others. I began to experience the best of Pancasila and this idea that people of different faiths can work together for the common good as common citizens. And on this trip, I was with a professor from Yale University, a wonderful man, sadly deceased now, but his name is Laman Sana. And he gave several briefings around the country that Lemina Institute arranged with Nahdlatul Ulema and Muhammadiyya and others. And he made an interesting comment, which I find to be very useful to our conversation today. He made a comment about batik Islam. Batik, for our non-Indonesian friends, is this shirt that I'm wearing, this colorful shirt, and that it represents different regions around Indonesia, and you can see these in the pictures. But Laman said this, batik Islam is an Islam whose structure and fabric is the same, whose application varies with local color. It looks good on us and is good for us. And I thought, what a wonderful statement. A shirt is a shirt is a shirt. Islam has core theological tenets that never change. But according to the local context and variations, there is an opportunity to express one's faith while keeping the core tenets. And I thought, this is a wonderful comment, hopefully about my own tradition, which happens to be Christianity, or any tradition. If we are to live in a world of deep difference, then we have to have the capacity and the flexibility to interact locally and not be defined against each other, but be defined by what we are, the best of our faith as we engage others. And I think this kind of Pancasila, the best of Pancasila, the best of batik Islam, is exactly what the world needs today. Here is the world according to me. It's very simple, actually. It's complicated, but very simple. On the right is our examples of all the global challenges that we face. They have one characteristic. They cannot be solved by one actor, one government, one NGO, which is also to say that it is not a question of if, but when you will work with somebody who does not hold your beliefs, does not hold your values, does not look like you, does not pray like you. So the question then becomes, how do I engage the other? How do I operate at the center of this Venn diagram? All those actors are present, whether we like it or not. Government, international organizations, defense issues related to security and stability and extremism, business, different coalitions around the global challenges to the right. How do I engage and operate across all of these diagrams? And then there's religion. I make religion into its separate circle to call attention to it. But the truth is this, people of faith are in all the circles and they are influencing all of the actors. How do we engage each other with respect to get something done practically in a world that has these multiple challenges? So here's my formal definition, my informal definition of cross-cultural religious literacy. There's you, the other, and what you do together. Whether you like it or not, you have to find a way to partner. So what is the academic definition? Here's something that you can read if you like, but please, I'll explain it in very simple terms. To engage somebody else, you have to have skills. Yeah, to my mind, you have to have the skills of evaluation, negotiation, and communication. But those skills take place within competencies. Competencies like knowing yourself, knowing the other, and knowing the context in which you're trying to get something done. Now, it's very important to understand this. The word literacy, it's not fluency. I will never know Indonesia. I have several batik shirts, but that does not make me an expert in Indonesia. I will never know the language and the faith as it is applied in that local context. And the same is true of any country that I would go to. So literacy, first and foremost, is about a posture of humility. It is a posture of listening and seeking to learn and come alongside partners in that context. I should also be very clear. Literacy, cross-cultural religious literacy, is not syncretism, and it is not secularism. It is an opportunity to understand our theological and political differences, not to demean the other, but to give them dignity, to understand the essence of their identity that they bring to the table in the middle of the Venn diagram to address the global challenges that we all face. So here are my definitions of each of the competencies and the skill sets that are needed. A personal competency just means, what is my moral framework? What do my holy scriptures say about the other? I first came into full awareness of this when I began traveling to Uzbekistan. This is at the Rajasthan in Samarkand. I wrote my PhD on Uzbekistan. And I was there and I was literally surrounded by these giants, but they were the giants of the Islamic golden age, Al-Biruni, Ulugh-Beg. And I had never studied them. I had never heard of them, to be very honest. And I needed to think through why that was so. Where was I coming from? Literally, what was I coming from my part of the world? What was my worldview to think about this kind of Islam that was so scientific, so erudite, so smart, so long before my own country? These were things I had to understand, but to understand them, I had to understand myself first and what my beliefs said. Next, you have to understand the other. You may recognize this picture, my Muslim brothers and sisters in humanity. This is the grave of Imam al-Bukhari, also in Samarkand. If I am to understand the other, I cannot project my understanding onto them. I have to understand them as they understand themselves. So if I'm to engage the Muslim majority world, I need to think about the people that shape their theology, their thinking about best practices, about their values, about how, as the Holy Quran says, to compete for virtue. What does that mean? What does that look like? Well, I have to understand Imam al-Bukhari. This is a delegation that we brought of Americans, men and women, Jews, Christians, Muslims, to Uzbekistan to understand this part of the Muslim majority world and how through Imam al-Bukhari and others, al-Biruni, it has influenced the rest of the world. Third, we need a collaborative competency. And this is where we get into practical application. And this is where we have to ask the tough questions. Do I have the will? Do I have the skill to engage the other? Do I have the time to think through the different cultures that are at play in a given context as I build a partnership around a practical project that serves all of society? This picture is taken on the Tibetan Plateau. It took 5 years to get to this picture, to be very honest, building relationships. The women dressed in traditional Tibetan dress are Han Chinese. They speak Mandarin. They represent the government. Officially, they're secular or atheist. But yet they're working with local Tibetan Buddhists who consider the environment to be a part of their religion and stewarding the environment to be a part of their faith. And they were trying to improve agriculture and the environment in that part of the Tibetan Plateau. So there was an issue of common self-interest that brought them to the table. But they also needed the skills and the will to engage and learn from each other from a posture of humility. And that's what we need most of all. So what are the wills and skills, the will and the skills to make that happen? The first skill I think you need is evaluation. And I would say this, all the skills take place internally and externally. You're always understanding your internal life and your values and assessing your capacity to engage as you assess the external environment. So the first skill of engagement at the middle of the Venn diagram, engaging people who don't look or vote or pray or believe like you do, is evaluation. What about myself? Do I have friends who can challenge me on my biases or reveal biases that I didn't know that I had? Externally, can I look at the environment and say, is religion a factor? Is it one among several factors? Maybe I should not pay attention to it, or maybe it's the primary factor. And by the way, religion can have a good effect or it can have a bad effect. This picture is a picture of the Federal Advisory Committee to advise the Secretary of the State at the time, Hillary Clinton about engaging civil society. There were several working groups on gender, on labor, on human rights, and I was asked to lead or co-chair the working group on religion and foreign policy. I was asked to lead an effort of 100 academics and NGOs and practitioners from around the United States to evaluate the American government on its organizational capacity to engage religious actors worldwide. I think this is a profound mark of humility to ask others outside the government to do a critique. And we came up with some practical solutions. One was to create an Office of Religion and Global Affairs that is now called the Office of Strategic Religious Engagement at the State Department. Another was to create a national interagency plan to engage religious actors on the various issues, all the challenges that we saw to the right of the Venn diagram in the previous slide. The next skill we need is negotiation. We're always negotiating our identity when we engage another culture. We're always thinking about our own beliefs. What is key about my own belief? What is truly scriptural? What is something that maybe I'm reflecting my culture and not my scripture? And at the same time, you have to negotiate with others to get a practical project done. And often that begins with a negotiation of terms of reference. Do we have common understanding of common words so that we can work together? This is a very particular tense negotiation. This is in Tunis in September of 2012. And we had been invited by the Swiss government who facilitated the conversation. I was asked to bring a delegation of Muslim and Christian Americans to meet with Salafis from across the Middle East and North Africa. Not your average meeting. But it was September 12th, 2012. And this is the day after Ambassador Stevens, the American ambassador to Libya, had been murdered in Benghazi by Libyan Salafis. And as it happened, the person to my right in this picture was a Libyan Salafi. And as I sat down, he grabbed my arm and said, "I'm very sorry. This is not my Libya. This is not my Islam. I was not expecting that." But it helped ease the tension. And then we had a very serious discussion about who is God? What is a believer? What is the sovereignty of the people, democracy, in the context of the sovereignty of God? These are the kinds of conversations we have to have across deep differences in order to work on projects together. This is the kind of negotiation we need. And it's not always easy. Last slide. The last skill is communication. I had a friend from Peshawar. His name is Akram Khan Durrani. He was the chief minister. And he came to my country. There were reports that people around him had said that 9/11 had been done by the Jews and the CIA. I did not know how to talk to him about this, but I knew that I had to. So I took him to the big hole in the ground in New York City where the two Twin Towers had been. And this moved him terribly because he, in his own country, had seen people, a terrorist, use their religion to validate the killing of fellow Muslims. And he said, "This is not Islam." And because of that relationship, we began to have conversations about Isa al-Masih, Jesus the Messiah, as he's known in the Holy Quran, and that we had differences of opinion about his nature and purpose, but we could talk about them as friends because we had learned to talk about the tough issues and respect our eternal differences. He invited me to Peshawar 3 months later for a state dinner. He was the sixth highest political officer in all of Pakistan. And I was a nobody from America, a Christian who was worked for a small NGO. This is the kind of communication we need. So all to say, we have to find ways to work together. In Indonesia, they have a salad called gado-gado, where all the ingredients are brought together and a special peanut soil sauce is brought on. In Uzbekistan, they have a pilaf, and all the ingredients are brought together to create a great dish to serve everybody at the table. the key to gado-gado and the key to pilaf in Uzbekistan is that the ingredients are not melted together, but they retain the essence of their identity to create something better that serves everyone. And this is the kind of meal that we have to serve, the kind of table that we have to prepare. Thank you.
Terima kasih, Dr. Chris Saipo. Selanjutnya, saya ingin mengundang Ibu Dr. Minhas Majid Khan, Profesor di University of Peshawar, Pakistan, yang juga Fellow di IGE Center for Women, Faith, and Leadership, untuk memberikan pemaparannya. Kepada yang terhormat, Ibu Dr. Minhas Majid Khan, kami persilahkan. Waktunya 15 menit.
Thank you very much, Matthias. Assalamualaikum to everyone. Good evening and good morning to all guests, audience, and dignitaries. Well, much has been explained by Chris Saipel. I'll just go through the terms religious literacy and pluralism and how they are understood in most of the Muslim countries. Because religious literacy and pluralism are the backbone of peace and stability in any society. And like in any Muslim society, there are sensitive issues, for example, religion's interpretation, religious curricula of both public and private sector schools and universities and madaris as well. Then donation to mosques and funding of madaris through unknown sources. And certain Islamic laws that some view as responsible for increasing intolerance and rejection of pluralism in Pakistani society. Now, these issues have a serious impact not only on religious minorities, but also on Muslims having secular views. The dissension in Pakistani society is due to its drift from tolerance and pluralism proposed in its founding vision by the founding father and the desire for a country where all citizens have equal rights. I'll start with the hypothesis of my talk, which is threefold. And that is, number one, there's a widespread illiteracy about religion, not only in Pakistan or for that matter in the Muslim world, but also the globe. Second, one of the most troubling and the urgent effect of religious literacy is that it most often stimulates intolerance and hate, hence creating hurdles in the efforts for promoting respect for tolerance, peaceful coexistence, and joint efforts in local, national, and global levels. And finally, it is possible to reduce or eliminate religious illiteracy by teaching about religion from a non-sectarian angle in primary and secondary schools. On the other hand, the ability, if we are to define religious literacy, I would say the ability to recognize and study the interpretation of religion and social, political, cultural life through different lenses. A religiously literate person will have the following characteristics. Number one, the basic understanding of the history, central text, beliefs, practices, and existing manifestation of several of the world's religious traditions. And number two, the ability to know and explore the religious dimension of political, social, and cultural expressions across time and space. So these definitions deduce that religion shapes and is shaped by social historical context, out of which particular religious expression and influences emerge, And there is a difference between religion understood through the lens of personal devotional practices and the academic study of religion. Now, one of the most troubling and urgent consequences of religious illiteracy is that it is often it fuels prejudice and antagonism, thereby hindering efforts aimed at promoting respect for pluralism, peaceful coexistence, and cooperative efforts in Pakistan. As we all know, that Pakistan came into being in 1947 for the Muslims of Indian subcontinent. During the inauguration of the Constituent Assembly on September 11, 1947, Qaid Azam Muhammad Ali Jinnah, the founding father of the nation, declared his vision for Pakistan as, and I quote, "In any case, Pakistan is not going to be a theocratic state, to be ruled by priests with a divine mission. We have many non-Muslims, Hindus, Christians, and Parsis, but they are all Pakistanis. They will enjoy the same rights and privileges as any other citizen and will play their rightful part in the affairs of Pakistan." Unquote. However, Pakistan found it difficult even decades after its independence to determine its identity, mostly because the weak liberal leaders could not dare to offend the tough orthodox leaders and clergy in the initial days of Pakistan. And it is also believed that this search of collective identity since 1947 is reflected in different and infrequent approaches to educational policies and curricula. Now, the incidence of extremism, or I would say violent incidence of extremism and radicalization in Pakistani society demonstrate the deep-rooted intolerance. Many believe that the intersection of religion and in politics is the source of all ills in Pakistan. As a result, some suggest the exclusion of religion from politics, while many disagree with the notion that the religion has anything to do with intolerance and hence violence. It is nevertheless a fact that religion has been used or misused in all such incidents. But unfortunately, the nature of political system in Pakistan has remained inconsistent due to constant breakdowns of the constitution and the political order, lack of democratic institutions and processes, the military interventions in politics, and the rapid expansion of bureaucratic elite. And many point to the rule of General Ziaul Haq, the martial law administrator from 1977 till 88, as a principal reason as to why intolerance, religious extremism, and spread in Pakistan that resulted into today's intolerant society. Again, various circles express that the textbooks in school also present a distorted history of the origin of Pakistan, in which exclusion of facts and inclusion of official narrative of Pakistan as an ideological state is presented, that shaped one religious identity resenting others. And many scholars criticize madaris as and sometimes mosques as mediums or a source for promoting extremism, sectarianism, social and political views. They believe that as a source of indoctrination of youth, there is no check on madrasa curricula and registration and the sources of their funding. Hence, its education in a way rejects diversity and inculcates intolerance and radicalization in the society that leads to militancy. However, the government on many occasions resisted them and acquiesced to the religious elites, allowing more narrowly Islamic religious content from the madaris to be placed into the existing curricula of the public schools. Then religious education, as we know, is a compulsory subject in Pakistani schools, in which students learn basic knowledge about Islam without exploring the sectarian differences between each sect of Islam. And the division of the Muslims into Sunni and Shia, and the further division of Sunni Muslims into different sects, has caused massive sectarian violence in Pakistan. So there's a need for evaluation and improvement of the teaching and learning about religions in schools in order to explain misperceptions about practical applications, as well as to engage religious education with diversity. Even though religious education does not support sectarian or minority religions differences, individual opinion about sectarian differences are still a major component of divisiveness in Pakistani society. Moreover, because of the social discrimination and religious intolerance, religious minorities become victims of violence. Most of the religious and political leaders, including representatives of religious minorities and government officials, during an interview with me when I was doing my postdoc research, they said that intolerance is not the result of society, but extremist religious groups perpetrating violence are perpetrating violence against religious minorities. Then the incidence of religious intolerance, despite the efforts by the government or various quarters in the society, are still on the rise in the form of hatred, violence, and extremism towards religious minorities or other minority sects, and even towards Muslims. The extremist element play on the religious sentiments of the masses and incite mobs. Culturally speaking, religion at time is subjected to a host of different interpretation, largely due to widespread ignorance and illiteracy, and is perpetuated in some cases as acceptable or social practices. For example, honor killing in most of the backward areas in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa, in Sindh and Punjab, and Balochistan as well. So the trend in intolerance and radicalization has also gripped schools, colleges, and universities, where many innocent people have lost their lives because of false accusation, contentions, hatred, personal vendetta. At times they are accused of blasphemy. One of the students in Mardan at Abdul Wali Khan University was murdered on false allegation of blasphemy. So this is how intolerant the society has become. And an irony in Pakistan is those who are against intolerance and support a pluralist society are labeled as non-religious by religious radicals who are not religiously literate. If some of these are asked to translate a verse of the Holy Quran, they would not know its meaning, what to say of its interpretation. And in a society when there are few religious scholars and many religious illiterate, it is very difficult to express views on religion and interpret the scripture in a politically moderate way. The extremists reject the notion of diversity, pluralism, and peaceful existence.
2 minutes.
Well, there's a lot of left. But I'll just, you know, touch upon the main things in my paper. So religious literacy and pluralism in Pakistan have remained an issue of great concern and debate globally. I can give you some example of the concerns shown by international community. One is the Financial Action Task Force in June 2018 placed Pakistan on its gray list for terror funding and money laundering, and was given a plan of action to complete or face the risk of being blacklisted. Pakistan was also placed on US State Department's country of particular concern list for violation of human rights, particularly discrimination against religious minorities. And most recently, the European Parliament adopted a resolution for review of trade relations with Pakistan and ending its eligibility for generalized scheme of preferences, that is GSP plus status, in the light of current events, acts of violence, extremism against non-minorities or political leaders, or those people who they consider as un-Islamic or of secular view. So I think no country live in isolation, and it is true in case of Pakistan. What is needed now is to address the concern of international community regarding the issues that I've highlighted. Some I could not. Therefore, it is important to explore the possibility of engaging with religious literacy and religious education to explain the purpose, content, and practical application of religious education so as to ease the existing challenges linked to religion in Pakistan. It is also important to create a national counter-narrative and its acceptance by all the by all to refute the extremist narrative by inviting religious leaders as a mean of engagement and as a theory of change pursuant to pluralism. To inculcate the true meaning of religious leader literacy in society, there should be a top-down and a bottom-up effort. It is important to understand religious literacy as a mean to help government officials, academicians, religious and secular scholars to correct this drift by crafting state policies and social approaches that enable all to enjoy equal rights irrespective of their caste, color, or creed. There were some efforts by the government, like the government introduced registration of madaris, their reforms, scrutinization of the religious material and the text in school, beside banning all militant outfits or organization in order to prevent the spread of hate and violence towards minority groups of all kinds. The previous democratic government tried to change this approach, but it needs engagement of all stakeholders. And the current government of Pakistan, Tehreek-e-Insaf, introduced single national curriculum in 2020. However, despite these measures, missing links exist between policy making and policy implementation, which need to be addressed to guarantee and ensure religious tolerance and a pluralist approach in government laws for the good of all and for the security as well as stable and peaceful Pakistan. Thank you.
Terima kasih, Dr. Minhas Majid Khan. Narasumber kita berikutnya adalah Bapak Dr. Alwi Shihab, Senior Fellow dari Institut Lemena. Beliau juga utusan khusus Presiden Republik Indonesia untuk Timur Tengah dan OKI 2015 sampai 2019. Kepada yang terhormat Bapak Dr. Alwi Shihab, kami persilahkan. Waktunya 15 menit.
Terima kasih. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Yang saya hormati Dr. Syahrizal dari Universitas Nahdlatul Ulama, Profesor Chris, Profesor Minhaj Khan, distinguished guests and participants, allow me to present in Indonesian language. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Berbicara mengenai literasi keagamaan lintas budaya dari perspektif Islam, saya ingin mengambil contoh relasi antara kelompok agama-agama Samawi, yaitu Yahudi, Kristen, dan Islam. Mengapa demikian? Pertama, karena ini adalah salah satu contoh relasi antar agama yang banyak dibicarakan oleh Al-Quran. Pandangan Al-Quran dalam relasi terhadap Yahudi dan Kristen akan menolong kita memahami relasi antar agama yang berbeda secara umum, serta prinsip-prinsip yang relevan untuk memahami literasi keagamaan lintas budaya. Kedua, sekalipun ketiga agama Samawi ini memiliki banyak kesamaan dan akar sejarahnya dalam perjalanan sejarah hingga hari ini, seringkali terjadi kesalahpahaman. Artinya, relasi ketiga agama ini masih relevan sebagai contoh mengapa literasi keagamaan lintas budaya ini diperlukan dan diharapkan dapat ikut memberikan solusi. Mari kita mulai dengan menelusuri akar sejarah ketiga agama Samawi ini, yaitu dengan kembali ke figur sentral yang penting dan utama dalam tiga agama tersebut, yaitu Nabi Ibrahim alaihissalam. Nama Nabi Ibrahim terambil dari suatu kata dalam bahasa semantik kuno di Babilonia yang artinya menyeberang atau mengembara. Dan itu dari itu anak keturunannya disebut bangsa Ibrani. Seakar kata dalam bahasa Arab, abara, yang artinya melintas. Nabi Ibrahim alaihissalam dijadikan sosok teladan dan panutan bagi manusia, terutama atas usahanya menjelaskan Tuhan yang Esa kepada kaumnya. Qad kanat lakum uswatun hasanah fi Ibrahim. Sungguh benar, ada suri teladan yang baik bagimu pada diri Ibrahim dan orang-orang yang bersama dengannya. Hari ini dalam webinar ini, kita berusaha meneladani Nabi Ibrahim dalam upaya bekerja sama secara konkret untuk menciptakan kehidupan yang harmonis antara keturunan agama-agama yang bersumber dari Nabi Ibrahim alaihissalam. Kita sadar bahwa perjalanan sejarah interaksi antara ketiga agama ini tidak selalu menyenangkan. Namun sebagai Muslim tentu saja sikap dan perilaku yang tidak sesuai dengan ajaran Al-Quran perlu kita koreksi. Cukup banyak referensi yang bisa dijadikan dasar berinteraksi dengan komunitas Yahudi dan Kristen, atau apa yang disebut dalam Al-Quran sebagai Ahlul Kitab. Agar kita tidak terjebak dalam penafsiran keliru, maka setiap petunjuk dalam Al-Quran harus dikaitkan dengan konteks sejarah atau asbabin nuzul, yakni waktu turunnya ayat tersebut. Misalnya hubungan dengan kelompok Yahudi di masa Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam sangat berkaitan dengan konteks sejarah masa itu, yang tentu tidak dapat diterapkan di konteks lain. Demikian pula penafsiran ulama tertentu bagi suatu ayat Al-Quran yang tidak dapat dijadikan ketetapan yang absolut. Bagi suatu ayat Al-Quran juga tidak dapat dijadikan ketetapan absolut yang ditafsirkan oleh ulama-ulama yang tidak sesuai dengan keadaan sosial budaya masa kini. Dengan kata lain, bentuk penyelesaian suatu masalah yang diyakini kebenarannya pada suatu saat dan tempat tertentu dapat berubah pada konteks waktu dan tempat berbeda. Bahkan dimungkinkan terjadinya perbaikan atau penyempurnaan yang dapat diterima dan disesuaikan dengan kemaslahatan bersama. Demikian halnya dengan pelaksanaan ajaran Islam. Ijtihad atau pandangan baru dari ulama tumbuh secara dinamis dan cepat. Oleh karena itu, kekakuan sikap yang mengabaikan realitas sosial budaya, apalagi menafikan tradisi masyarakat, akan menimbulkan gejolak dan berpotensi disharmoni dan konflik horizontal. Kondisi sosial budaya yang majmuk dan beragam selalu memerlukan adanya titik temu. Titik temu dari berbagai kelompok-kelompok yang ada. Dalam konteks ini, hubungan antar ketiga agama Ibrahim dapat ditemukan titik temunya untuk menjadi sebagai jembatan emas guna mencapai tujuan bersama. Anjuran ini adalah bagian dari ajaran Islam yang penting dalam menjalani dan menjalin hubungan dengan Ahlul Kitab. Qul ya Ahlul Kitab, ta'alu ila kalimatin sawa bainana wa bainakum. Katakan, wahai Muhammad, wahai Ahlul Kitab, marilah kita menuju pada suatu kalimat pegangan yang sama antara kami dan kamu. Keteladanan Nabi Muhammad dalam membangun masyarakat plural dengan menghormati semua pihak di Madinah secara jelas tertuang dalam Piagam Madinah. Kemudian dilanjutkan dengan semangat yang serupa oleh Khalifah kedua Umar bin Khattab yang dikenal sebagai Piagam Aelia di Jerusalem. Kemudian berlanjut di Andalusia, Spanyol selama 500 tahun oleh penguasa Muslim dinasti Amawi, di mana semuanya mengikuti jejak Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam dalam mengimplementasikan strategi politik kemajmukan. Suasana hubungan harmonis, rukun dan damai antara komunitas Yahudi, Kristen dan Islam digambarkan dalam ungkapan yang tepat, Three Religions of One Bedroom, sebagai simbol kerukunan, keharmonisan, dan perdamaian. Tiga agama hidup dalam satu kamar tidur. Sebuah wujud yang sangat nyata tentang hidup berdampingan secara harmonis dan saling menghormati sejalan dengan anjuran Islam untuk bertoleransi. Pluralisme dalam pengertian kemampuan hidup bersama yang saling tolong-menolong dilandasi nilai-nilai luhur yang menghargai perbedaan adalah salah satu nilai keislaman yang tinggi dan penting. Sekaligus merupakan ajaran pokok Islam yang relevan pada masa kini. Dalam kaitan ini, Islam mengajarkan umatnya agar melakukan dialog secara beretika, dewasa dalam berinteraksi, dan santun khususnya dengan Ahlul Kitab. Al-Quran mengingatkan bahwa kelompok Ahlul Kitab tidak semua sama. Ada pujian-pujian tertuju kepada kelompok tertentu dari mereka. Dan bahkan dinyatakan bahwa kelompok tersebut akan mendapatkan tempat layak bersama kelompok yang beriman dan yang beramal saleh. Laisu sawa min ahlil kitabi ummatun qa'imah, dan seterusnya. Mereka tidak sama. Di antara Ahlul Kitab ada golongan yang lurus. Mereka membaca ayat-ayat Allah pada malam hari dalam keadaan bersujud. Hadirin peserta webinar yang saya hormati. Prinsip dasar ketuhanan yang Maha Esa melahirkan paham persamaan manusia dalam aspek martabat dan harkat. Prinsip ini berefek pada tidak diperkenankan seseorang merendahkan derajat orang lain, apalagi memaksakan kehendaknya kepada orang lain. Bahkan Nabi Muhammad SAW diperingatkan oleh Allah bahwa tugas dan misi beliau hanya menyampaikan kebenaran, bukan memaksakan kebenaran. Tidak ada paksaan dalam menganut agama Islam. La ikraha fid din. Law syaa'a rabbuka la amana man fil ardi kulluhum jami'an. Afa anta tukrihun nasa hatta yakunu mu'minin. Seandainya Tuhanmu menghendaki, tentu semua orang di bumi seluruhnya beriman. Apakah engkau, wahai Muhammad, firman Allah, akan memaksa manusia hingga mereka menjadi orang-orang mukmin? Jika mereka, kaum musyrik, berpaling, sesungguhnya kewajibanmu, wahai Nabi, hanyalah melakukan penyampaian yang jelas. Faman syaa'a falyu'min wa man syaa'a falyakfur. Yang mau mengikuti ajaranmu boleh, dan yang siap untuk mengingkarinya juga tidak apa-apa. Oleh karena itu, bekerja sama melalui titik temu yang disepakati dapat melahirkan karya-karya produktif demi kebaikan bersama. Keesaan Tuhan adalah inti semua agama yang benar yang dibawa oleh para nabi-nabi yang dimulai oleh Nabi Ibrahim alaihissalam. Oleh karena itu, Al-Quran menyampaikan bahwa titik temu tersebut harus dikembangkan dan dibangun untuk menjadi landasan hidup bersama. Sebagaimana pesan Al-Quran di Ali Imran, Inna arsalnaka bil haqqi basyiran wa nadhira wa in min ummatin illa khala fiha nadhir. Sesungguhnya kami mengutus engkau dengan membawa kebenaran sebagai pembawa berita gembira dan sebagai pemberi peringatan. Tidak ada satu umat pun kecuali telah datang kepadanya seorang pemberi peringatan. Oleh sebab itu, penting dipahami di sini bahwa Al-Quran tidak menjadikan perbedaan agama sebagai alasan untuk tidak menjalin hubungan kerjasama, apalagi untuk bersikap tidak bersahabat. Dengan catatan, selama mereka tidak memerangi atau mengusir kaum muslim dengan motivasi keagamaan. Namun sangat disayangkan, terdapat sebagian dari kelompok muslim tidak menyadari sebab atau syarat larangan Al-Quran untuk menjadikan kelompok di luar Islam sebagai teman kepercayaan.
2 minutes.
Al-Quran tidak menjadikan sebagai larangan bersahabat tanpa sebab dengan orang-orang Yahudi dan Nasrani secara mutlak. Kekeliruan ini terjadi karena ketidakcermatan dalam memahami konteks ayat tersebut di atas. Bahkan terdapat sebagian kelompok umat Islam yang menyamaratakan semua agama di luar Islam, menjadikannya sulit berpandangan dan bersifat positif kepada agama lain, atau menghormati dan mengedepankan keharmonisan terhadap agama lain. Faktor terbesar penyebabnya antara lain berasal dari penafsiran-penafsiran yang disampaikan oleh ulama-ulama yang terpengaruh pada konteks perang yang terjadi antara umat Islam dan umat Kristiani. Padahal Al-Quran menyampaikan beberapa pandangan positif dan inklusif terhadap Ahlul Kitab sebagaimana yang disebutkan tadi. Intinya adalah keharusan bagi umat Islam untuk memahami Al-Quran dengan baik berikut konteks-konteksnya. Kehidupan manusia dalam rangka melaksanakannya harus memperhatikan hal tersebut. Tidak terhindarkan terjadi penafsiran dari waktu ke waktu seiring dengan perkembangan kehidupan manusia. Oleh karena itu, beberapa penafsiran tertentu masa lalu memerlukan kajian ulang dengan tingkat kecermatan dan kehati-hatian yang tinggi. Literasi keagamaan lintas budaya yang dikembangkan oleh Profesor Chris memberi kerangka yang tepat bagi kajian-kajian ulang dalam konteks masyarakat dunia yang semakin majmuk. Kerangka ini mengajak kita memahami penafsiran dalam konteks relasi dengan yang berbeda agama dan kepercayaan. Tiga kompetensi penting yang dijelaskan. Pertama, kompetensi pribadi, yakni pengetahuan seseorang akan kerangka moral dan kerangka berpikir agamanya sendiri, pemahaman isi kitab sucinya, dan apa pandangannya terhadap agama yang berbeda. Misalnya relasi antar Yahudi, Kristen, Islam. Apa yang saya sampaikan hari ini adalah contoh bagaimana sebagai umat Islam memahami pandangan Al-Quran secara utuh dan kontekstual, hal yang penting untuk kita dapat membangun relasi dan kerjasama. Tidak hanya dengan Ahlul Kitab dalam konteks ini, tapi dengan agama-agama lain. Kompetensi komparatif mirip dengan kompetensi pribadi, tetapi di sini kita belajar memahami kerangka berpikir agama yang berbeda sebagaimana dipahami penganutnya. Alasannya sederhana, bagaimana kita bisa bekerja sama kalau tidak membangun relasi? Bagaimana bisa membangun relasi kalau kita tidak mau saling kenal? Lalu penting untuk memahami sebagaimana dipahami oleh agama lain atau penganut agama lain, yaitu memahami cara berpikir agama tersebut dari pengaruh penganutnya langsung. Ini penting, terkadang kita takut terhadap yang berbeda karena persepsi yang salah. Akhirnya yang kompetensi yang terakhir adalah kompetensi kolaboratif, yaitu kemampuan seseorang untuk menemukan titik temu antara penganut agama-agama yang berbeda. Dari sini, dari sana mampu menjalin kerjasama untuk kebajikan bersama. Dalam hal ini Islam tidak saja menganjurkan untuk bekerja sama dalam kebajikan, tapi justru mendorong untuk saling berlomba dalam mencapai kebaikan bersama. Bahkan kemajmukan atau pluralitas umat manusia menjadi sebuah keniscayaan dan kenyataan yang telah menjadi kehendak Tuhan. Ketiga kompetensi tersebut sangat penting dan diperlukan dalam membangun relasi dan interaksi positif dengan tetap menjadi diri sendiri dan yakin akan kebenaran agama kita masing-masing. Kompetensi ini berfungsi sebagai alat, tools, dalam mempelajari nilai-nilai keyakinan pihak lain dalam rangka menghindarkan diri dari timbulnya ketersinggungan yang dapat berpotensi menimbulkan kerentanan konflik. Kompetensi tersebut juga ditujukan untuk membangun pemahaman terhadap perbedaan nilai-nilai melalui dialog dan komunikasi dari sumber utama mereka, bukan dari pandangan pihak ketiga. Sekian, semoga bermanfaat. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Terima kasih Bapak Dr. Alwis Syihab. Selanjutnya saya akan membuka kesempatan untuk bertanya jawab dengan ketiga narasumber. Pertanyaan pertama adalah untuk Bapak Dr. Chris Seipel. Saya persilakan pertanyaan tersebut untuk dibacakan.
Pertanyaan dari Cindy Kwan. Dari mana pertama-tama kita perlu, bahkan harus, memulai aksi-aksi konkret dalam mewujudkan tiga kompetensi dan tiga keterampilan yang telah dijelaskan, sehingga bisa menjadi suatu kebiasaan yang mengakar pada diri setiap manusia? Apakah pertama-tama dari pendidikan formal? Jika ya atau tidak, bagaimana gambaran konkretnya? Apa saja tantangannya dalam mewujudkan kompetensi dan keterampilan tersebut? Terima kasih.
Silakan Dr. Chris Seipel.
Thank you. That's a fundamental question and a great question. For me, education is about how to think, and that's the competencies, and training is what to do. That's the skills. But your question is exactly right. Where do you go to think this way, or begin to think this way, or get these kinds of skills? So for me, this is the future of cross-cultural religious literacy. What programs around the world can develop this kind of competency and skills to enable students to, by design, be prepared for experience, as opposed to my experience, which was de facto discover these things and then take 20 years to figure out what I was doing. So I think that's the next big step. What institutions are going to do this? And I think that the key to that is going to be three things: case studies, role playing and scenarios, and larger simulations about a complex context. And I think schools that are able to do this are going to be better teachers of leadership and engagement, such that you can take on these challenges. But I can't tell you where I would send you to get these skills and competencies right now.
Terima kasih, Dr. Chris Saipul. Berikutnya pertanyaan untuk Dr. Minhas Majid Khan. Silakan dibacakan.
Baik. Untuk Bu Minhas, sejauh mana aktivitas pemerintah untuk mengkonter permasalahan intoleransi, ekstremisme, dan sektarianisme dalam kurikulum di sekolah? Tidak adakah pelibatan gerakan keagamaan atau NGO untuk mengkonter hal tersebut? Terima kasih.
Silakan Dr. Minhas.
That's a very interesting question. I would say that the government from time to time has taken initiatives, but at the same time, they do not want to offend the religious elements, I would say, or the clergy to design policies that are not, against the basic principles of Islam. Like, for example, many people would criticize blasphemy law and certain NGOs, many activists, including government parliamentarian from different political parties. They have asked for reforms in the blasphemy laws. But the issue is so sensitive that the moment the government decide to reform these laws, these elements start protesting. They come on streets because they have street powers, particularly these religious elites. So it is very difficult, for the government to make policies which are not favored by, these religious elites. One thing that is encouraging at the moment is the government decision to restrict religious teachings to Islamiyat or to religious studies only. Even on that, there was a lot of hue and cry from the public and particularly the religious lot. So government is trying. It has on many occasions taken measures. Like, for example, geotagging of madaris registering all madaris, checking the sources of funding of these madaris. So government in a way is keeping a check on all these activities. It has banned many militant outfits, but they cannot openly, you know, oppose these religious right or the conservative religious elements who I just as I mentioned, they have street power. They can bring people on the streets to protest against the government. So government, I think, do not want to offend them, any political party, whether it is a religious political party or a secular political party. They would not want to make policies which are, you know, can arouse the sentiments or emotions of these people.
Terima kasih, Dr. Minhas. Selanjutnya, silakan dibacakan pertanyaan untuk Dr. Awi Shiha.
Baik, pertanyaan untuk Bapak Dr. Awi Shiha yang pertama adalah dari Bapak Argo Twikromo UAJY. Pertanyaannya, agama sering bergandengan tangan dengan politik ataupun menggunakan cara-cara kekerasan. Dalam konteks semacam ini, mayoritas yang menginginkan keharmonisan justru menjadi diam dan melakukan pembiaran terhadap kejadian politik maupun kekerasan yang terjadi di lapangan. Bahkan juga seringkali terlambat melakukan reaksi dan pencegahannya. Memang literasi keagamaan bertujuan untuk mencegah terjadinya peristiwa intoleransi dan kekerasan agama maupun yang menggunakan politik. Namun tetap menyisakan kebocoran-kebocoran terjadinya peristiwa yang tidak diinginkan tersebut.
Silakan.
Terima kasih atas pertanyaannya. Pertanyaan ini sering sekali saya terima dari teman-teman. Selalu saya katakan bahwa kalau ada unsur politik yang mencampuri ajaran agama, maka itu akan menjadikan kelompok yang ingin mengusahakan suatu kekuasaan di bidang politik akan menjadi bias, akan menjadi mempunyai pandangan yang tertentu, tidak lagi melihat nilai-nilai agama yang sebenarnya. Kalau kita melihat sejarah, hubungan antara agama Islam dan agama Kristen pada mulanya sangat baik sekali, bahkan teman-teman sahabat Nabi waktu di Mekah berhijrah ke Ethiopia, yang melindungi sahabat-sahabat Nabi ini adalah penguasa Kristen di Ethiopia, Najasyi. Tetapi mari kita lihat perjalanan sejarah. Kenapa terjadi perang salib? Dari kedua belah pihak telah menggunakan keinginan menguasai Yerusalem, menjadikan hubungan yang mestinya harmonis karena mempunyai nilai-nilai yang sama di dalam saling menghormati, saling mencintai, tetapi itu semuanya dikorbankan karena inginnya kekuasaan menjadi panutan mereka. Dari pihak Islam ingin kekuasaan itu tetap di tangannya di Yerusalem, dan dari pihak Kristen merasa bahwa dengan kekuasaan Islam di Yerusalem pada waktu itu menjadikan orang-orang Kristen sulit untuk datang dan melakukan ziarah dan kunjungan ke Yerusalem, di mana tempat itu adalah tempat yang sangat sakral, tempat yang mempunyai nilai sejarah yang luar biasa. Kembali kita melihat di mana-mana yang terjadi, apabila kekuasaan sudah masuk di dalam menggunakan agama, maka sentimen keagamaan itu akan menjadikan hubungan antara baik sesama pemeluk agama, apalagi dengan agama lain. Kita bisa lihat di dalam Islam sendiri, antara kelompok-kelompok tertentu saling bunuh-membunuh. Kita lihat di pihak Kristen juga demikian. Sampai sekarang, Inggris dengan Skotland, dengan Irlandia, masih sering ada gesekan karena ada unsur politik di dalamnya. Jadi kita menghimbau para pemuka agama agar jangan ikut di dalam arus politik pada saat kita memberikan pencerahan kepada umat. Saya kira itu yang saya dapat sampaikan.
Terima kasih, Dr. Alwi Shihab. Kita akan lanjutkan pertanyaan untuk Dr. Chris Saipul. Silakan dibacakan.
Question from Fatih Burmey, Assistant Professor at University of Sfax, Tunisia. The problem lies in accepting the other as he or she is before starting to think of any collaboration. My concern is that many extremists or people, whatever their religion, refuse the other.
Silakan, Dr. Chris Saipul.
Yes, that's the problem. And that's what we have to figure out. You know, to link your question, which is excellent, with the previous two comments, the state is never going to provide the solution to extremism. The state, at best, is reactive, and it's a hammer. It's needed, but that's not the solution. The solution to extremism comes from society. And it comes from religious leaders and lay leaders, men and women, who challenge and hold their fellow believers to the standards of Holy Scripture. Now, here's the problem, as Minhas has suggested. Religious leaders have sometimes are afraid to speak because there are various elements of extremism in society, from religious nationalism all the way to terrorism. And they're afraid to speak out against an extremist form that varies with the scriptures. And part of the reason, I think, my opinion, that they're afraid to speak out is that they have not been equipped. And I can only speak as a Christian. I do not speak for Muslims and Jews, obviously, and I speak from the Protestant tradition. But often we equip Protestant preachers to be good on theology, but they don't know how to relate theology to all the different sectors of life. And so if you believe in the sovereignty of God, all of a sudden the bigness of God gets reduced to a building on Sunday. And there's a quiet, you're scared to speak out and say, no, that's not what Jesus said. Jesus said, love your neighbor, and he said, love your enemy. Well, how do you do that? So I think the key to all of this is equipping religious leaders through formal and informal training to better engage society and relate their theology to all of society. Because I think the texts in the Abrahamic tradition are rich with examples of engagement. And as Dr. Alwi Shihab said, from our father Abraham, he crossed over. He was obedient. He was faithful to go to another place when he didn't know where he was going or who he would meet, but he trusted God. We need that same kind of example today in our religious leaders. So to put a conclusion on it, Part of this is good theological training, but part of this is, I believe, religious leaders need to be trained in religious engagement, in diplomacy, because they are representing society, they are representing country, and the people in general trust their religious leaders more than they trust their politicians. Only the best of faith defeats the worst of religion. And our religious leaders have to claim that and teach that through their own example and through their own example of being equipped to engage issues other than just theology.
Terima kasih, Dr. Chris Saipo. Selanjutnya, pertanyaan ditujukan ke Dr. Minhas Majidkan. Silakan dibacakan.
Yeah. This question from Imam Shamsi Ali, Dr. Imam Shamsi Ali, Imam of Islamic Center for New York and Director of Jamaica Muslim Center. In the past few years, we have the rise of racism, particularly in the form of white supremacy. How each religious tradition should respond to this tendency in our world? And second, what's the best possible way to change the seemingly systematically attempt to demonize Islam worldwide? The world is surely stand unjustly on whom to be accused to being radical and whom to be highly prized as moderate. The UN, for instance, till now hasn't included white supremacy on the list of terrorist organizations or groups, despite the US law enforcement consider white supremacy as the most dangerous group worldwide.
Silakan Dr. Minhas.
Okay, yes, thank you. Now, I cannot, talk about the white supremacist. I cannot talk about the white supremacists, but racism, of course, there is in every country around the globe, and each race believes they are, better than the other one. As far as religion, is concerned, in the Quran, it is said that in the eyes of God, everyone is equal. There's no, difference, or there's no, a black is not a lesser child of God than the white. So everyone in Islam is equal, irrespective of their caste, creed, religion, and etc. As far as your second question is concerned, you asked about, that how we should differentiate between a moderate and a radical. So I would say that for that, I think religious literacy is very important, because most of the people in all religions are not religiously literate. Moderation in religion, on religious belief or religious thought, is that you agree to disagree. You are ready to accept the other as he is or she is, despite of disagreeing with many of the things or many of his actions, that you do not agree with or you do not appreciate, but you have the tolerance to, listen to him, give him space to express his views. And the radical, I think, would be one who's not ready to listen to you, who's not ready to argue anything that he does not believe in, who would, who would not even believe in dialogue, who would not sit on the table to discuss the issues that may be of mutual interest, that may be for the, benefit of all. Because, these days Islam is projected as a religion that is, at times is, synonymously Islam is, tagged with terrorism or extremism. Who are a terrorist or who are extremists? They belong to one religion, and that religion has been, stereotyped because of those people who are following the faith of Islam, and they are engaged in act of terrorism, the extremism. They do not have tolerance, patience to listen to others or to accommodate them. They do not agree in pluralism, a pluralistic society. Only a label on them that they are Muslim makes them religiously literate, as they believe it. But unless and until there's religious literacy in the country, in the globe, I think these things would time and again happen. These acts of terrorism has spread to the globe. These acts of terrorism and violence would continue to take place around the world. But at this point, I believe it is about Islam and its followers and their idea of, dealing with people of other faiths. I hope I have understood your question correctly, and I have responded and answered your question. Thank you.
Terima kasih, Dr. Minhas. Berikutnya, pertanyaannya ditujukan untuk Dr. Awi Shihab. Silakan dibacakan.
Pertanyaan untuk Bapak Dr. Awi Shihab dari Fatimah dari UIN Wali Songo. Bagaimana mengembangkan kemampuan literasi agama lintas budaya di suatu negara, sebagai contoh negara Indonesia? Jika pembelajaran agamanya yang merupakan salah satu komponen dasar literasi agama menganut model monoreligius, di mana siswa belajar agama sesuai dengan apa yang dia anut saja. Terima kasih.
Idealnya seorang yang belajar agama, dia seharusnya dan idealnya mempelajari agama-agama yang lain. Mempelajari agama-agama yang lain dari sumber aslinya. Jadi kalau dia mau mempelajari agama Kristen, dia jangan membaca buku yang mengkritik Kristen, tapi dia membaca buku yang ditulis oleh orang Kristen. Demikian juga bagi orang Barat, jangan dia membaca buku-buku yang dikarang oleh orang atau oleh kelompok yang tidak mencerminkan ajaran Islam yang sebenarnya. Jadi itu nomor satu, dia harus mempelajari nilai-nilai agama yang lain sesuai dengan apa yang dianut oleh agama tersebut. Lalu kita berusaha yang mempelajari agama atau agama-agama untuk mencari titik temu, agar melalui titik temu itu kita bisa bekerja sama. Kita tidak perlu mencari titik temu yang bisa menciptakan konflik. Dari itu, para pemuka-pemuka agama yang berkecimpung di dalam religious harmony atau hubungan antar agama, mereka memesankan dalam berdialog jangan berbicara tentang teologi. Karena teologi ini adalah suatu hal yang menjadi pegangan utama bagi pemeluk agama. Dan apabila teologi yang diusik, ini akan menciptakan suatu konflik mungkin, kesalahpahaman mungkin, tetapi justru hal-hal yang bisa dipersatukan antara agama-agama atau antara agama yang kita ingin pelajari. Taruhlah kalau di Indonesia, kita bisa berhubungan dengan semua agama yang ada tanpa kita masuk ke dalam perdebatan teologis. Kita mencari titik temu apa yang ingin dicapai oleh komunitas Kristen, apa yang ingin dicapai oleh komunitas Islam. Yang jelas kita semuanya, bangsa Indonesia menginginkan adanya keadilan sosial. Keadilan sosial baru bisa tercapai apabila korupsi dapat diatasi. Nah, ini saja bisa menjadi titik temu di antara pemuka-pemuka agama. Nah, saya ingin menyampaikan bahwa di Jogja sudah ada program yang mempelajari agama-agama tetapi tidak secara dogmatis, tetapi secara deskriptif. Artinya apa? Bahwa kita mempelajari umpamanya agama Islam, siapapun yang duduk di kelas atau di institut itu, kalau tidak salah cross-cultural university atau apa yang di Jogja, di mana UIN dan Universitas Kristen menjadi sponsor. Nah, di situ tidak diajarkan hal-hal yang sifatnya dogmatis. Apa yang artinya dogmatis? Menceritakan umpamanya Islam yang paling benar, agama lain ini yang masuk neraka. Itu bukan yang diajarkan yang hal-hal yang semacam itu, tetapi diajarkan umpamanya apa kontribusi agama Islam, apa kontribusi agama Kristen untuk kemajuan dan peradaban Indonesia, apa kontribusi agama Hindu, dan sebagainya. Tidak masuk ke dalam kepercayaan dogmatis. Dan apabila kita sudah masuk ke dalam hal-hal yang sifatnya dogmatis, pasti tiap penganut akan mengatakan agamanya yang paling benar, dan hal itu tidak ada salahnya. Tetapi jangan kita katakan bahwa agama kita paling benar, lalu agama Anda yang paling salah. Nah, itu yang keliru. Kita katakan bahwa menurut kami Islam yang paling benar, dan kami menghormati dengan keyakinan Anda bahwa agama Hindu, agama Kristen, agama Yahudi juga paling benar bagi penganut-penganutnya. Jadi kita tidak melakukan semacam interaksi yang konfrontatif, tapi interaksi yang akomodatif dan inklusif. Dengan demikian, kita bisa mengembangkan kerjasama yang bermanfaat bagi masyarakat kita secara umum.
Terima kasih, Dr. Alwi Shihab. Kita masih bisa mencoba untuk satu termin lagi. Untuk itu, untuk pertanyaan ketiga untuk Dr. Chris Saiful, silakan.
Pertanyaan dari Haniatul Kusniah, Madrasah Aliyah Negeri 1, Malang, Jawa Timur. Seperti telah dijelaskan sebelumnya, literasi beragama tidak lepas dari peran pendidikan di suatu negara. Sejarah Indonesia membuktikan bahwa hubungan dialogis dan intoleransi dilahirkan oleh pendidikan atau kurikulum. Pertanyaan saya, apa yang harus dilakukan oleh guru ketika kurikulum yang ditetapkan oleh negara atau kementerian belum atau ternyata justru melemahkan spirit dialogis tersebut?
Silakan, Dr. Chris.
Yeah, another wonderful and hard question. On the one hand, I think that States are doing the best they can. Bureaucracies are always slow. It doesn't matter the culture. And they're trying to address these issues. And like I said, the state is always reactive. It doesn't matter which country. So what can you do then is I think that it's the responsibility of teachers and religious leaders to conduct their own curriculum review, to make suggestions about pedagogy, about how teachers are trained. Because if the teacher doesn't believe it, then it doesn't matter what the curriculum says. And I think the teacher has to be the embodiment, this issue has come up before, of pluralism. Pluralism in my context sometimes is a negative word because it means syncretic and there are no differences. But in my own writing and work with my colleagues, Dennis Hoover and Chris Stewart, we call it covenantal pluralism. The responsibility or obligation to not only engage, but respect and protect the other without necessarily lending moral equivalency to the other's beliefs or behavior. We agree to disagree, as Minhaus said, agreeably. The teacher has to facilitate an atmosphere in the classroom of a covenantal pluralism, where the religious or ethnic minority has an opportunity to speak as an equal. And unless the teachers understand that, then it doesn't matter what the curriculum is. So I would say that you have to take a step back and say, how do we teach teachers? And then how do teachers embody a covenantal pluralism that teaches cross-cultural religious literacy and the skills of engagement? And that has to begin in the classroom. And as I said in my earlier comment, I think the classroom has to be the place where case studies are examined, where there is role-playing and individual relationships, and you take on the role of the other, where I would play a Madari leader in Pakistan or a madrasa leader in Indonesia, and that person would play a Christian from America or a Christian from Jakarta. And then the third part, of course, is simulation. Could you do group exercises that looks at issues of varying degrees of urgency with time limits? You have to make decisions now. This is real life. This is how you think about things. What are you going to do? This is the best kind of thinking because you can help people think about experience through the case studies, the simulation, and the role play that builds leadership. And then they have a library in their head for real life. They have a point of reference for a case they can pull off the shelf when they go to real life and they say, oh my gosh, I'm dealing with this situation. What do I do? Well, I have these skills. I have these competencies. I have these examples. I'm going to pull from each of those to have the best solution for this moment because it has to be practically applied. So I don't mean to be evasive. I just mean to say there needs to be a lot of work thought on how a teacher is taught and how the teacher creates an atmosphere of a covenantal pluralism in the classroom that teaches the skills and competencies of cross-cultural religious literacy through case studies, role play, and simulation. And we have all something to say on that because we're all not doing a good enough job.
Terima kasih, Dr. Chris. Pertanyaan berikutnya adalah untuk Dr. Minhas Majidkan. Silakan dibacakan.
Pertanyaan dari Eka Abdul Hamid, STAI 11 April Sumedang. Apakah kebanyakan kelompok ekstremisme yang berkembang di negara Pakistan mengaku beragama Islam? Lantas, apa upaya yang dilakukan oleh pemerintah dalam menanggulangi ekstremisme di kalangan masyarakat, terutama di masjid atau madrasah? Apakah pemerintah Pakistan melakukan penangkapan terhadap partisipan-partisipan ekstremis? Oh iya, menurut Dr. Minhas, mana istilah yang tepat, ekstremisme atau radikalisme? Terima kasih.
Silakan.
Okay. Now, Yes, you're right. Extremist groups are, majority of them are Muslims. And since Pakistan was in objective resolution of 1949 declared as Islamic Republic of Pakistan, so the official religion of the country is Islam, and around 97% of the population is Muslim. In its initial days, there were 25% non-Muslim, minorities, but that has dropped to, I think, 3%, or less than that, or about it. But looking at the figures from 25 dropping to all down to 3 or 4 or 5% of non-Muslim. So majority of the population is Sunni Muslims, 15 to 19 are Christian, Shia Muslims. So within the Sunni population is again divided into Shia, into Devbandis and Barelvis. Now all these sects within Islam, in a way, are in conflict with each other, not agreeing to each other's beliefs or the practices that are, both the Devbandis and the Barelvis are engaged in. And together they do not approve of the activities or the practices of the Shia Muslims. And then it comes to, the non-Muslim minorities. Pakistan constitutions, very clearly mentions that the prime minister, the president, the governors, even the chief ministers can only, slots are only to be occupied by Muslims. So a non-Muslim cannot, be a president or prime minister or governor for that matter. So basically it is that, constitutional, the constitution in a way is, sidelining its non-Muslim population. They do have representation in the parliament, but they do not have, policy or decision-making power. So first step or the first type of extremism comes from the constitution, where you are, in a way negating your own population. That is non-Muslim. And then comes the role of a religious elite that in a way is pressurizing the government to make policies that are Islamic. Like, for example, from time to time, they asked for Hudud Ordinance enforcing Hudud Ordinance, Sharia law, and it was done during General Zia time. So from that time onwards, this extremism or extreme thoughts or radicalism, I would say, started from that time, when you are imposing your laws or strict laws on all of your citizens, irrespective of their religious or faith or belief. So and the second question was how the government is dealing with these extremists or radicals. The government, like recently we had TLP protest against the French president remarks. So they were asking the government to send back the French ambassador back to France. The government, I was happy that they did not, you know, did what was these religious bigots expecting from them. But then again, it was, you know, the use of religion, Islam, and the name of the Prophet that these religious bigots were, you know, using to incite mob. And then the government decision of not, you know, accepting all their demand was something that in a way would discourage other groups as well. It the TLP was banned, Tehreek-e-Labbaik Pakistan. It was banned by the government. Its leaders, because many people got killed during the protest and the mob. The government, you know, lodged FIR against them. Many of their leaders were arrested. Even when they were negotiating with the government after the negotiation did not let them free. So I think in a way government, because government, like I said in my, talk, that Pakistan cannot live in isolation. It has to, you know, interact with different countries economically and politically as well. So they have to keep, you know, these things in mind. The policymakers have to, you know, consider these things before, you know, agreeing to the demands of these religious elites. So one strict action by the government would send a message to other radical groups that the government is not bowing to their demands. So I think in this way, the government is taking a very positive step, positive measures to counter these radicals or the extremists. And what was your last question? Sorry, I couldn't hear that. Well, I think both are synonyms. You know, an extremist can be a Christian, a Buddhist, a Hindu, a Muslim, a Christian, anyone. And radical, again, radicalization in a society, I think, is such extremist would act for himself. A radical would, you know, invite other people, particularly those people who are not religiously literate, to, you know, come with him and take radical steps against the those who have secular views, who are, you know, liberals, who are on the left, who do not, you know, agree with those radicals. So this is how I define it, that an extremist is one who is doing extreme or who is engaged in extreme actions by himself. But a radical is someone who would, you know, call on other people, like-minded people, to come together and take steps against the opposing party.
Terima kasih, Dr. Minhas. Selanjutnya, pertanyaan terakhir sebelum kita menutup semuanya adalah dari Dr. Alwi Syihab. Silakan dibacakan.
Pertanyaan untuk Bapak Dr. Alwi Syihab dari Amsterdam Manan. Pertanyaannya adalah bahwa kerap kali yang menjadi masalah adalah ketika negara ada pandangan mendesain kelompok tertentu dan mengembangkannya dengan tujuan sengaja menciptakan konflik sosial horizontal untuk membatasi sikap kritis warga negara terhadap negara. Atau ada pula pandangan bahwa kalangan radikal dalam kasus tertentu kadang dipakai oleh suatu kekuatan global untuk memuluskan agenda global seperti penguasaan sumber daya alam. Bagaimana tanggapan Bapak? Terima kasih.
Ini perbincangan soal pemerintah yang seakan-akan menempatkan satu kelompok sebagai kelompok yang di-frame menjadi radikal atau mungkin teroris. Ya, itu yang berkembang sekarang di sosial media, tetapi kita harus adil dalam hal ini, sampai di mana anggapan itu mempunyai bukti-bukti. Nah, itulah gunanya pemimpin-pemimpin agama bisa melihat secara jeli sampai di mana tuduhan-tuduhan itu benar atau keliru. Jadi saya tentu tidak bisa memberikan tanggapan saya. Umpamanya pun saya mempunyai pandangan, saya tidak punya bukti-bukti apakah membela pemerintah atau membela kelompok yang merasa dianiaya. Tetapi yang jelas, pemerintah yang tidak mendengar kritik, maka dimanapun dia berada, apakah di Indonesia, apakah di luar, ini ujung-ujungnya akan berakhir kepada disharmoni antara pemerintah dan masyarakatnya. Kita bisa melihat umpamanya di negeri Arab sekarang, banyak sekali contoh-contoh yang masyarakatnya tidak setuju dengan pemerintahnya dan akhirnya keadaan tidak aman dan tidak stabil. Nah, kita harapkan di Indonesia ini kita berpikiran yang jernih dan jangan kita hanya berpihak kepada satu kelompok yang akhirnya nanti akan mengakibatkan masyarakat kita yang berjuang ini, masyarakat yang ingin sejahtera, terganggu disebabkan karena adanya konflik yang terjadi, walaupun konflik yang ada sekarang lebih banyak di sosial media. Ya, kita harapkan bahwa mereka yang merasa tertindas, sekarang ada pengadilan, ada Komnas HAM, semuanya bisa dijadikan tools untuk menyampaikan keluhan dan kritik dan protes terhadap apa yang mereka anggap sebagai kesewenang-wenangan pemerintah. Saya kira itu jawaban saya. Saya tahu bahwa tidak memuaskan, tapi sekedar untuk memberikan pandangan yang mungkin lebih dingin daripada pandangan yang keras-keras yang kita dengar di sosial media. Ada pertanyaan yang kedua tadi apa ya?
Ada pandangan yang menyatakan bahwa kaum radikal juga digunakan untuk kepentingan global, misalnya untuk mengambil alih sumber daya alam di wilayah tertentu.
Ya, di mana-mana kepentingan global ini menjadi keluhan di khususnya di negara-negara berkembang ya, bahwa ada kepentingan global yang masuk ke suatu negara. Yang sangat terasa sekarang itu di Afrika. Semuanya orang tahu betapa satu negara yang ekonominya kuat dan masuk ke Afrika sambil memberikan bantuan dan lain-lainnya, tetapi pada saat yang sama kekayaan negara itu juga ikut menjadi bagian dari usaha kelompok yang merepresentasikan dirinya sebagai kelompok luar itu mengganggu kestabilan pemerintah. Saya belum melihat bahwa di Indonesia ini ada kekuatan global yang ingin menggerogoti Indonesia. Kita masih melihat bahwa nasionalisme kita cukup kuat dan kita tidak bisa membiarkan ada kekuatan-kekuatan luar menguasai kekayaan bangsa ini. Semoga hal ini menjadi kenyataan.
Terima kasih, Dr. Alwi Shihab. Bapak-Ibu sekalian, dengan berat hati kita harus menutup sesi tanya-jawab ini. Terima kasih kepada Bapak-Ibu sekalian yang telah mengirimkan pertanyaannya. Kami mohon maaf apabila pertanyaan Anda belum sempat dibacakan. Sekarang kami ingin mengajak para narasumber untuk menyampaikan kata penutupnya, masing-masing 2 menit. Pertama, kami ingin mempersilakan Dr. Chris Seiberg untuk memberikan kata penutup.
Thank you. And thank you to Nahdlatul Ulema University and to Lemina Institute for hosting this much-needed conversation. I think the easiest way to conclude would be to leave you with 3 words. The first is humility. I am humbled by the interest in the questions and how great and excellent they are. And we need to keep listening to each other. We need to keep learning from each other. Please, if there's ways to make this concept better, please fill out the feedback page. Tell us words that might work better in your local context or things that they're missing. It's an emerging concept that has been built on global experience, and we need more of them. The second word would be urgency. Clearly, all of our countries and cultures and religions have made some mistakes in how we think about these things, especially the relationship between an ethnic and or religious majority and ethnic and religious non-majorities. We need urgency, but we don't need to do something to do something. That's where mistakes are made. So let's be methodical and deliberate and careful in our thinking, and especially careful in how we equip teachers so that they can equip others within traditions, within educational institutions, et cetera. And then the last thing I would say is practicality. We've tried to create a framework with cross-cultural religious literacy that is useful to the academic as a framework and it promotes holistic and interdisciplinary thinking. But more important to me still is that the framework is of use and of simplicity to the person who never gets a certificate, never goes to college, but they understand it so they can do real things in a real world where there are real challenges and we just have to find ways to get to work together. There is you, the other, and what you do together. My hope and prayer is that this framework helps that person do something one partnership at a time, one relationship at a time that makes all of society better. Humility, urgency, practicality. Thank you again for your time.
Terima kasih, Dr. Chris Seiberg. Selanjutnya, kami mempersilakan Dr. Minhas Majidkan untuk memberikan kata penutupnya. Silakan, Dr. Minhas.
Thank you very much. First of all, I am very grateful to the host of this international webinar for bringing together such wonderful people, having heard them of has, you know, enhanced my knowledge and in a way has inspired me to learn more about my own religion and to learn and read other religions as well. My friend Chris Seiberg has concluded this or his concluding remarks were a few words, and since he's a source of inspiration for me, he has motivated so many people, and I've learned so much from him. So again, I would say that three words are very important as far as this cross-cultural religious literacy and pluralism are concerned. Number one, I would say, is patience. Because patience is something that we need to, you know, own. We need to have patience to be able to live in a society where people are different from us. We are different from so many others. We might be a majority and other a minority, and in some cases we may be a minority and others a majority. So this patience would, in a way, give us an opportunity to live in a multicultural, multi-ethnic, multilinguistic society. Then the second is tolerance. Tolerance, because I think it also, in a way, train us for cross-cultural religious literacy and covenantal pluralism, as Chris had mentioned a while ago. We need to tolerate the other. And then the other would be, you know, tolerating us as well. And final is acceptance, that we have to accept the difference of the other, that he's different from us or we are different from them. And once we accept that difference, only then we'll be able to engage in dialogue with them. We would be able to share the differences between them. We'll be able to discuss the common things between us. And once we have patience and tolerance and acceptance of each other, only then we'll be able to work towards the common goals that two different or three different groups might have. And as a teacher, I think one of the things is for a teacher is important, for a teacher that is very important, is to be a role model. Your actions, the way you speak, the way you communicate your message, the way you interact with people, this is all, you know, something that presents you as someone who is to be followed or who is not to be followed. So my message is for the teachers, for the leaders, to be role models, because if you are role models, you will have like-minded people around you. And when like-minded people, whether they are 3 or 4 or 10 or 30, when they are together, they would be able to, you know, multiply the number of like-minded people, and which is very important for peace within a society and across the globe. Thank you.
Terima kasih, Dr. Minhas. Berikutnya kami mempersilakan Dr. Awi Shihab untuk memberikan kata penutupnya. Silakan, Dr. Awi Shihab.
Terima kasih. Saya sangat bergembira dan berbahagia bisa berpartisipasi dalam webinar ini. Saya melihat webinar semacam ini sangat penting untuk bisa didengarkan dan diresapi oleh para mahasiswa, pemimpin-pemimpin masa depan. Saya ingin menggarisbawahi apa kata pembicara yang terakhir, Profesor Minhas, bahwa mari kita biasakan untuk menghormati pandangan orang lain. Mari kita membiasakan diri untuk tidak menjadi seorang yang eksklusivis absolutis. Artinya, hanya saya yang benar dan saya yang paling benar. Harus dihindari kalau kita ingin berinteraksi harmonis dengan pihak lain. Bukan saja dengan pihak agama lain, tetapi dalam lingkup agama kita masing-masing, perilaku menghormati perbedaan itu sangat penting. Yang kedua, banyak sekali kita terbelenggu oleh pandangan-pandangan ulama yang bisa mengarah kepada radikalisme, eksklusivisme, disebabkan karena pandangan ulama-ulama ini lahir pada konteks yang berbeda dengan konteks di mana kita berada sekarang. Jadi kita jangan mensakralkan pandangan ulama. Yang kita harus sakralkan adalah Al-Quran dan hadis yang dijamin sahihnya. Karena hadis juga bermacam-macam tingkatannya. Sehingga kalau kita membuka diri kita untuk mendengar pendapat-pendapat orang lain, kita akan bisa berinteraksi secara positif dengan siapa saja. Dalam rangka hubungan kita dengan Ahlul Kitab, mari kita kembali kepada Al-Quran. Ada beberapa ayat yang perlu kita renungkan kembali, yang saya teringat Al-Baqarah 62, Al-Hajj 17, Al-Ma'idah 69, di situ menggambarkan Al-Quran begitu inklusif. Dan juga tadi yang saya bacakan bahwa tidak semua kelompok Ahlul Kitab itu sama. Ada di antara mereka yang selamat. Ini pendapat Al-Quran. Tetapi kalau kita kembali kepada pendapat ulama, penafsiran daripada ayat-ayat yang inklusif ini sudah berubah menjadi pandangan yang eksklusif. Ada beberapa tokoh di Timur Tengah yang berani untuk mengkritik ulama-ulama yang sangat absolutis dan mengatakan bahwa pandangan-pandangan yang absolutis ini tidak memberikan peluang untuk kita bisa berhubungan secara harmonis dengan pihak lain. Kita tentu saja melihat betapa agama Yahudi, Kristen, dan Islam mempunyai titik temu dan persamaan-persamaan. Jangan kita ingat sejarah yang kelam pada masa lalu. Tapi mari kita kembali kepada Al-Quran dan kembali kepada keteladanan Nabi. Dan tiap ayat di dalam Al-Quran, kita harus sesuai dengan ketentuan, harus mengetahui konteks asbabin nuzul. Jadi jangan sampai asbabin nuzulnya untuk konteks A, kita gunakan menjadi ayat itu di konteks B. Itu tidak benar menurut ahli-ahli tafsir. Jadi saya mengajak khususnya anak-anak muda untuk kembali melihat kepentingan kita menghargai pandangan orang lain demi persatuan kita dan demi hubungan yang harmonis yang kita bisa bangun bersama-sama. Tanpa ada prejudis dan tanpa ada perasaan bahwa kita yang paling benar, karena Al-Quran mengajarkan kita agar kita sama-sama menerima ketetapan Tuhan di hari kemudian. Wallahu yafsilu bainahum yawmal qiyamah. Tuhanlah yang akan menetapkan siapa yang benar, siapa yang salah. Walaupun kita sangat yakin bahwa agama kita paling benar, dan juga kelompok sana sangat yakin bahwa agama mereka paling benar. Dengan demikian kita bisa membangun kerjasama yang produktif untuk kepentingan kita bersama. Sekian, wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Terima kasih Dr. Alwi Shihab. Bapak-Ibu sekalian, kita telah sampai di penghujung acara webinar internasional kita kali ini. Akhir kata, atas nama Universitas Nahdlatul Ulama Indonesia dan Institut Lemena, kami mengucapkan banyak terima kasih kepada seluruh narasumber yang telah hadir di acara ini. Kepada Dr. Chris Seipel, Dr. Minhas Majid Khan, dan Dr. Alwi Shihab, terima kasih banyak buat kontribusi yang telah Anda berikan melalui acara ini. Kami sangat menghargainya. Kepada Bapak-Ibu peserta webinar, baik di Indonesia maupun di negara-negara lain dimanapun Anda berada, terima kasih buat kehadirannya. Terima kasih juga kami sampaikan kepada seluruh panitia dan tim kerja yang telah bekerja keras untuk mempersiapkan webinar ini. Selamat malam untuk kita semua, dan sampai jumpa di acara berikutnya.